to welcome Mature to the show this afternoon. We just heard your first piece of music that you've chosen, Starman by David Bowie. Why did you choose that one? What's the story behind that?
It took me all the way back to, was it 1972 or something?
There or thereabouts, yeah.
It has to be my all-time favourite album. I did a Radio 4 programme recently on the 40th anniversary of that record, so I got to chat to the guys who are still left alive from the Spiders from Mars. Didn't get to chat to Mr. Bowie, unfortunately, but there will be other times. But I just think it's so evocative of that period, that early 70s. And when a record like that creates an absolute ambience, an absolute sound, it's just something quite magical. So it's great.
Would you say it was an influence on you as well?
Oh, huge influence. I defy anyone who played a guitar in that period or wanted to be in a band in that period who wasn't into disco, not to be influenced by that, because it was such a revelation, hearing songs like that and a production like that. And I think anyone's career, whether they choose music as a career or not, anyone's life, I should say, is a series of doors down a corridor, and each time one of these doors open, you're kind of exposed to a type of music you'd never experienced before. And we all have key moments in our lives that you think, that track meant so much to me, or that was a great period of music, or that I can remember. It's so evocative. I can remember my friends and who they were and what they looked like and what you were wearing and who the girl was you fancied and all of that stuff. Music does that to you.
Would this be the era about 72? Would you be putting Slick together then? Or
I was 72. I had just left my apprenticeship, a very difficult apprenticeship to get. I was an apprentice engineer in the outskirts of Glasgow.
Was it something that you were keen to get into, or
it was something
keen to get out of?
Something my parents were keen for me to get into. My father was a van driver all his life.
Right.
He drove for a bakery, and he instilled in my brother and I the need, the desire to get a proper job, so a skill of some description. And of course, apprenticeships were really big back then. I'm glad to see they're starting to kind of make a little bit of a comeback now, where you learn the craft, you learn a skill, and that skill would give you what you thought then was a job for life. It didn't kind of work out that way. You know, music was too heavily ingrained in my system, and I ended up doing this 2 years of this 4-year apprenticeship, playing in bands all the way through it, and then decided that, you know, it really wasn't for me, that music was too strong a calling, really.
And once you'd got your foot on the music ladder, was it something that you wanted to keep your foot on and keep a cling to as well?
Well, like anyone else, I'm not really skilled at anything else. You know, the only thing I can do is write songs and make music and perform. So if it all stopped tomorrow, I think I'd be probably driving a van like my father if I was lucky enough to get a job, if anyone trusted me. So yeah, there was nothing on my horizon other than music. My head was just full of it. You know, I was good at art. I could paint and draw, but all I'd painted and drew were guitars and amplifiers, which is pretty sad, really. But yeah, that was my little lot in life.
Now, your career path. I was having a look at, you know, you've got all these biogs left, right, and centre. You just Google you or something like that, and I thought, is this all one fella? Can't be. there was Slick, Visage, all the Fade to Grey stuff, and all that. But then I thought about it. And I thought, well, actually, yeah, there is a common sound throughout each one, almost a monastic sound. Is that something that you were aware of?
It wasn't something I was aware of, and I think we are all the kind of sum of our influences and the sum of our parts. You know, we are exposed to various things throughout life, and before I realised it, I mean, when I used to hate at school in Glasgow getting music lessons, what they called a music lesson, which meant you had to stand and sing, you know, step we gaily on we go, or whatever, some dreadful Scottish thing.
I'm going to assume that that's clean and decent.
Oh, very, very clean and decent, absolutely. As well, you know, absolutely, skipping through the Highlands, you know, heading off to go and marry Wee Jean or whatever it was. But, you know, all these folk tunes, all these traditional bits of music, which I really wasn't interested in whatsoever. My head was full of, you know, the Beatles and Jerry and the Pacemakers and the Small Faces and things.
Yeah.
But I realised much later on that all of that music had a huge impact on me. The melodies that we use in traditional Scottish music, the laments, the haunting atmospherics, all of that must have kind of permeated somewhere down the line. Because I did actually, when I looked back at some of the work that I'd done, you can hear those things in there. You can hear that sense of melody and that sense of drama coming through the music.
Mm. I noticed electropop was such a huge genre in the late 70s and through the 80s. But what surprised me was, because you were very much up there with the electropop, with Ultravox, and then suddenly a gear change and you're in Thin Lizzy. I thought, where's the connection there? Was that a conscious gear change?
It wasn't. You know, a lot of interesting things can happen without you having to plan them or manipulate them. And I'm a guitarist, a singer and guitarist first and foremost. And when I after Slick, I was fortunate enough to be asked to move from Glasgow to London to go and join the Rich Kids, which was a band put together by the original bass player and the Sex Pistols. And halfway through this kind of year and a half with the Rich Kids, I started listening to a lot of music coming out of Europe, a lot of the synthesizer music, and I wanted to integrate the synthesizer into the Rich Kids, which Glenn hated, so I ended up breaking the band up. I bought the synthesizer and we all kind of went our separate ways. Out of that came Visage, which is a studio project that I wanted to make. I wanted to learn how to, you know, produce records in a studio. So I started doing that, and through the process of making this album, I got the phone call from Philip Lynott, lead singer of Thin Lizzy, saying, we're in Arkansas or somewhere in America, and we're opening up a special guest to Journey. We're playing in front of, you know, 20, 30,000 people a night. Gary Moore is not in the band anymore. Can you come over in the plane tomorrow and finish this tour for
as
us?
As you do.
As you do. And it was a true, you know, and every possible connotation you could think of, a true Judy Garland standing in the wings moment, you know, and you get a chance to go on stage because the lead has just lost her voice or broken her leg. Well, Gary Moore wasn't in the band anymore. And I ended up going on Concorde to New York and getting a connecting flight to New Orleans, and within 48 hours of getting a phone call, I was on stage with Thin Lizzy bashing out The Boys Are Back in Town. It was phenomenal.
Marvellous. And then, of course, you actually did some original material with them later on.
I did. Philip and I, we met when I was still living in Glasgow, playing in the band in Slick. And I was a big Thin Lizzy fan and of the very early stuff. And I bumped into Philip then. And when I moved to London, I bumped into him again on a tube station and when I was with the Rich Kids. And we kind of renewed a friendship and ended up writing a few things together. We wrote a thing called Yellow Pearl, which became the theme tune for Top of the Pops for quite a few years.
Ka-ching with the royalties, I imagine.
It was fantastic. I mean, you know, talk about money for old rope. It was phenomenal. They asked me to do an instrumental version for Top of the Pops, which I very quickly did for them. And of course, at that time, I mean, if people don't know that every time a piece of music is played on the television, there's a fairly substantial payment goes along with that. And of course, because it was Top of the Pops, in those days when you'd have things like Saturday Swap Shop or whatever, they'd do the top 10 swaps and bang, in would come my tune. So that you think, ka-ching, yeah, there goes another payment. And every time they played it, you got paid again.
That's right. It was the front of the programme, the back of the programme, and also every time they did a countdown. Let's do from 30 to 20.
And there we go.
You just sat there going, there we go. Made life a bit easier. Must be a happy... Mind you need the talent to write it in the first place.
Well, you know, maybe a bit of luck as well. I don't know.
Now, the word Sex Pistols has been mentioned in there. Is this true or false? Were you offered the chance to be the lead singer with the Sex Pistols?
You know what? I don't know. And I know I was
a
asked...
crazy kind of era,
It wasn't that bad. I know I was asked to be something in the band that eventually became the Sex Pistols. I was stopped in the streets of Glasgow by a guy named Bernie Rhodes, who eventually went on to manage The Clash. And he asked if I could speak to his friend around the corner about music. Now, people used to stop me in Glasgow all the time because I was quite well known up there. Because if a band came to play the Glasgow Apollo and their guitars had broken, there were no rental companies to hire a new one. They'd go and find me and I would supply them with a guitar or an amplifier or whatever. So the guy that he was talking about in the car around the corner was Malcolm McLaren, who was quite a strange sight to behold, I have to tell you, in 1975. And... I sat in the car with Malcolm McLaren and Bernie Rhodes, and Malcolm told me all about his shops and the fashion and how he used to look after the New York Dolls and blah, 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 and talking about this new band he was putting together. And I realised that half an hour into this conversation, he hadn't asked if I was a musician. It didn't really matter to him. They stopped me because I had short hair. The rest of it they could fill in, I suppose. And, of course, lo and behold, the band became the Pistols. So I never found out whether it was the singer or the guitarist or a dancer. Who knows?
So nearly there, but too talented.
Couldn't spit far enough, that's what it was.
Oh, that'll be... Oh, don't. Gosh. See, now, this is... Where, as I say, I was reading a bio about you... And I thought, this can't all be one fella. I'm thinking, have they got two, three careers mixed up all in one here? You mentioned the association you had with Phil Lynott. Is it pure coincidence that one famous Irishman, you had another combination with another famous Irishman later on?
Well, you
or
know,
is there a connection there?
There's a connection. Of course, we
just
Celts,
call me Poirot if you
no,
will.
No, absolutely. we Celts all stick together. So, I know that. Although I can't remember the actual moment, but Bob Geldof and he obviously knew Phil, and Phil knew him. It was Ireland was quite a small place musically at the time. A lot of great musicians, but they all kind of knew each other, and they all left Ireland to come to London to try and make it big in the mainland. So there were big similarities there, and of course I was friends with Phil, and I'd met Bob many times. So the three of us actually knew each other. But nothing was set in stone at the time. It was way before there was any chance of Bob and I doing any kind of collaborative stuff together.
Okay, well, come on and talk about that a little later on, though.